And the concerts and the plays that are going to fill that building.
Lewis, this may be the best thing you've done yet.
No, the best thing I've done yet was get us up that mountain on Friday.
Whoever designed that gravity-feed gasoline tank under the driver's seat has never driven up a 40-degree incline to Lake Arrowhead, damn fool.
I'd have been the fool if you hadn't had the bright idea to take the top down and drive the rest of the way in reverse. We'd have been stuck forever.
Now, I'll remember the sight of you standing up at the wheel to see behind you uphill till my deathbed, I think.
I think my wife is busy trying to forget that sight as soon as possible.
She'll be fine. She'll see this building and remember tomorrow.
I hope so.
Well, I've got class. Congratulations, Mr. Plummer.
I'll see you later, Mr. Ames.
Relative of John Chapman. Johnny Appleseed? sounds blunt oranges. That's what we do best here. Blunt oranges. Here, try some. You won't be disappointed.
Just gonna not show up on us.
Why not?
It's just respectful.
We have another
person. Full table. We have an empty seat.
We don't need him though.
Anybody would be better.
If you say so. Let's just get playing. We'll do you in. All right. Know to play. Simple Texas Hold'em.
Easy.
Here we go. We're gonna do a buy-in of one. It's a simple buy-in.
Why do we always have to buy in?
We don't make
this is how it works. This is how it works.
I don't have the money, Wheatley. Fine.
You've been awfully quiet. What's going through your head?
Ames. He wants to give the department chair to Crookshanks. My position to that asshole. I've been here 9 years longer than him. I've been the physical education department chair for years. And now he wants me to be a counselor?
He's better suited academically, Glenn. That's what Plummer cares about.
Shield of cards. It's horse shit. He's holding back the whole junior college athletic department. If he lets recruit the way we want, we'd have our competitive edge back. If it isn't Elvin Ames, join us, Mr. Ames. We were just talking about how unfortunate it would be for your friend, old Louis Plummer, once we get rid of him and his stupid ideas about rules and regulations.
What are you talking about, Wheatley? What's going on?
A lot of people are upset about not getting what they feel they deserve, Elvin.
Five.
What they deserve?
Four.
Mr. Plummer gave me a job as a janitor. He helped me to get the schooling I needed to teach. I owe my career to this man. I owe my family to this man. We wouldn't have made it through the past few years if I didn't have that teaching position.
Yes. We know all about how cozy your family is with the Plummers. Your little shared vacation house in Lake Harrowhead. It's all very charming. You're one of Plummer's chosen ones. Things are gonna change around here, Ames. Might not be so cozy for you anymore once we get rid of Plummer.
I don't know what kind of crew you're all planning, but whatever bitterness you have about not getting that promotion or that building contract, you know it's not right for the kids. You've never seen a schoolman so dedicated to a school. You all know that. Hell, he saved most of these families, using that federal money to pay the boys to do janitorial work and their fathers to build the stadiums.
It's all well and good, but he should have thought a little harder about who he was passing over in the meantime. He's had a good run. I suggest you stick to your job, Ames. We wouldn't want to I have to find a new supervisor of maintenance, as well as a new superintendent.
This is wrong.
Have a good evening, Mr. Ames.
Five.
Five full.
Again? Let's go.
Okay.
You may have some business.
I can
to
see,
do.
Hey, wait, what?
We'll get
wait
out of here.
Wait a moment. See, you see, I feel like you're somebody I have to trust.
Close up, everybody.
Oh, no.
Well, thank you.
Are we down already? and going down to the school.
Fine, Harold, thank you.
Well, my boy's not giving you too much trouble.
Oh, he's doing very well.
What can we do for you?
The school's been approved for a federal program.
God damn.
We get $30,000.
That's incredible.
We have to account for it all and spend it all in 3 weeks. Whatever we don't spend goes back to the general fund.
That's several months worth of wages.
And I want every single cent of it to go into the pockets of our Fullerton men and their families.
All right, we're up for that. What do you propose?
We're going to hire 3 shifts and work around the clock. We'll put up lights so we can work through the night.
We're
going to build new buildings. And a new football stadium. One that goes north and south rather than east and west. So no one has the darn sun in their eyes the whole game.
I'll send the word out.
Yeah.
I can't remember if she hears
no.
I think Susie can
have it. Susie can only give each man 100 hours. After 100 hours, I have to turn him off and give someone else the work.
Seems fair.
We'll get all the adult men off the janitorial staff and into the building project. We'll hire students for the janitorial work, the yard work, and the cafeteria. Especially students who don't already have fathers in the work program.
More jobs for more families.
Exactly. And if we can spend this money, we can get more funding in the future. Good luck, Harold.
Good luck.
See you later, boys. Go to town, boys. I hope I'm in the right place. Miss Arletta?
Elsie!
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I'm glad I made it.
Welcome to the Bassentary Ranch School. This is it.
Oh.
It's small, but this is where all of the Americanization classes meet.
It's just fine.
You're going to love our students.
Well, I just hope they like me.
Oh, they will. The students invite me for meals at their homes. They make the most delicious little nopalitos. They're these chopped up little cactus shoots. They're quite good.
Sounds interesting.
So you'll be working with women and children in the morning and men in the evening. The children have regular school lessons, and the women want to better their English and learn to cook some American dishes. The men, however, want to expand their English vocabulary to make themselves more hireable.
But don't they already have jobs with the Bassentuaries?
There's a lot of moving around for the citrus workers, depending on which crops do well and when. That's why we don't follow the regular school year schedule. We teach throughout the summer, and we take our vacations after the orange season in October, November. The packing houses should have mentioned that to you.
Yes, of course. And is there any trouble with the law?
Everyone here is either an American citizen or legal resident, if that's what you're asking.
Oh, I only meant
the Bass children, the older Mexican families, and all the white children go to school down in town. All the recently immigrated and non-white are here with us.
I see.
Elsie Fawnin.
Hello.
Welcome. I was just coming by to water the flowers.
But it's Saturday.
It's hot. I don't want them to die.
That is so nice.
It's no problem.
How is your mother? Juana's mother's the best cook in camp.
She went into town by herself to go to the store.
That's wonderful. Juana usually translates for me.
Oh, I see. It took the dairy man several minutes to figure out because she asked for 2 pounds of Jesus. When she actually meant cheeses. She and my father laughed about that all weekend.
That is funny. But she did it. That's so wonderful.
Show me your flowers.
Oh, of course.
What are you planting? So, yeah, my mother loves roses. So, of course, I'm going to plant it for her because it's her favorite.
Hey, folks.
Yeah.
Water. Every.
Oh, no, no, no.
Oh, I drink?
You're a water.
I gotta stay sober for the job.
You're a bartender.
So it is real.
Hello, folks. What can I get you?
Well, the little lady can be bartender. I can sleep.
Oh, you little thing.
Why don't we just open?
Welcome. Oh, you got a lot of guts opening up in a bad time like this.
I think your thirsty people are everywhere.
The best go their own line. The rest of the fine folks of the Fullerton are too conservative to get thirsty.
May I tempt you to?
I'll just take a water.
Gin and soda, please.
Cheers. Thanks for coming in.
Tell your friends.
Oh, we
get to town very sometimes ways, but we'll get the word out. I'm a secretary at the high school. I'll get all the officers in here by next weekend.
I appreciate that. Anyone giving you trouble about a liquor license?
No trouble there, but quite a few teetotalers told me that Florida's the place for my kind of business.
Oh, well, there's some WPA projects happening soon. The men will have a little extra in their pockets. No buyer here.
You'll make it just fine. Change is good for this place. 10 years ago, the school fired the drama teacher because one of the board members saw that she had rolled her stockings when he saw her step off into the train. Can you imagine?
The school's still so strict?
We secretaries have a good time. Parties every month, but no liquor and no dancing.
What?
Oh, certainly no dance parties, especially not for the students.
No booze and no fun, even for the adults. Now you can see why they believe an actual bar had opened up.
And we really do need the cheering up. All day, from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. has to do with great lines of teachers looking for jobs wrapped around the administration. When they fire someone, it's my job to go out and announce the line. We fill positions. They're no longer looking for science teachers, Turkish English teachers.
Do you like the bar?
It's fair when they realize they waited all day and there's no more opening. I listen to the tales as well, which I don't doubt, but can't help.
They pour you another.
Thanks.
It's a miracle you're all hiring rather than firing.
We have to keep hiring. We have more students than we ever have. The ones who used to drop out to work or farm now have no work and no farm, so it's come to school.
She works for years.
Well, if the depression took away their jobs, that's because of education.
We're even adding subjects. We're teaching German again. We dropped that before, but I guess we've gotten over the idea that every German needs to be hated.
In that case, gross. So where do you want to exactly?
I work over at the school.
Oh, how do you do that?
Right now I'm on the janitorial staff, but this month I'll be moving up. We're going to build a new stadium.
Football.
Oh, excuse me, I have to use the restroom.
What's your job?
I'm a secretary for Mr. Plummer himself, actually.
Oh, well, I hear Mr. Plummer loves his secretary.
Oh, that's just a nasty rumor. He's quite a gentleman.
Oh, he is quite a gentleman to the ladies, that's for sure.
Single ball.
Against the wall. Against the wall. Against the wall. Backs against the wall. Everybody against the wall. Down here, please. About half of you come down here.
Let's take you, and you come with me. Come with me. Over to this side, please.
Down here, down here.
Over there.
Violin right next to this person. Shoulder to shoulder. You, down here, fill in the space.
Any troublemakers?
Fill in the space.
Any troublemakers?
Not yet. Let's see.
Do you need anybody from here?
You
go with him.
Me.
The rest of you are gonna stay with me. He's gonna go by.
Line up next to him.
Stand still. Do not move.
Quicker! Quicker! Thank you. Against the wall. Please.
Need any help on your side?
Not yet. You?
I'm good, I'm good.
You. This line, scoot down. Remember, we're doing this for your safety. We need speed. All right. Are we good on your end?
We're good over here.
Everybody, pack in tight. If you're not touching shoulders, you're not close enough. Stand up straight. Stand up straight. All right, folks. Time to board. Time to head on home.
This is our home.
Hey.
You can't do this.
Maybe you didn't understand me, ma'am. Against the wall. Because now it's time-o for you to leave-o and go back to your country.
I was born here. My brother was born here.
Against the wall. The Bastancheries are bankrupt. The ranch is closing. Federal agents have been kind enough to get you people one-way tickets home to Jalisco.
This isn't right. I never been to Jalisco.
Listen, lady. I don't have time for this. I've got 437 Mexicans. I've got to get on 9 trains. I can't argue with all of you. Down in line, scoot down. You're first.
Ready to board?
Almost. Make the count.
Here we go. You come with me.
Move. Follow through. Follow through. Right where this young lady is going.
Everybody
quicker.
Single file line. Get
quicker.
In.
Quicker. Quicker.
One by one, please get in as fast as you can.
One by one, we're not chaotic here.
Stay away from the walls, please do not lean on the walls.
Your will, our God, and the God of our fathers, direct our steps in peace. Guiarnos en paz, sostenernos en paz, y hacernos llegar a nuestro lugar con vida, alegría, y paz. Guide us and sustain us in peace, and allow us to reach our destination with life, joy, and happiness. Sálvanos de las manos de todo adversario y enemigo que acecha, de los bandidos y bestias salvajes del camino, y a todas las calamidades que pueden advenir y afligir al mundo. Save us from the hands of every adversary and enemy that lurks, bandits and wild beasts of the road, and all the calamities that can afflict the world. Confiere tu bendición a todas nuestras acciones. Grant us your blessing to all our actions. Concédeme gracia, bondad y misericordia a tus ojos y a los de todos los que nos contemplan. Y confiérenos tu afable bondad. Grant me grace, mercy, and kindness in your eyes, and those of all who behold us, and confer on us your gentle kindness. Escucha la voz de nuestra plegaria, pues tú escuchas la voz, la plegaria de todos. Bendito seas, oh Dios, que escuchas la plegaria. Hear the voice of our prayer, for you listen to the prayer of all. Blessed are you, O God. Hear our prayer. Amen. A gift from the church for you. A shawl to put around your shoulders. Please assist. Please assist. Please, my sons. My daughter. Please. Around your shoulders. Yes, please. It will be a cold journey. Let us enter the next room. Please, this way. We are going to go outside. Outside.
When the priests finally forbade our traditional dancing, more people joined Toy Perina in her resentment of the Spanish. She recruited 8 villages and led an armed rebellion against the mission. The fathers discovered her plans to use her shamanistic powers and violence to get rid of the mission. I hate the padres, and to all of you, for living here on my native soil, for trespassing upon the land of my forefathers, and despoiling our tribal domain. I came to fight, and not to quail at the sight of Spanish sticks that spit fire and death, nor to retch at the evil smell of gun smoke. they force her to convert. Banish her off to another mission hundreds of miles north from her family and village. And married her off to a Spanish soldier. And that was the end of the rebellion. And now, we'll do what we must to survive. I fear that our language, our sacred dances, our stories will not survive. You will tell the story of Toy Farina now, won't you? Tell it to your children. I must go.
This way.
Let's go this way. Stand here.
Gracias for preparing such a beautiful party for us. El Rancho Santiago de Santa Ana, my home, is more beautiful with you all in it. I never imagined as a young boy in España that my duties to the king would take me to a place such as this. When I moved with Bordola to Alta California, I never knew a place could be so uncivilized and yet so beautiful. A coastline of unfulfilled potential, waiting for the taking. I am filled with pride that my children have lived only in this wild place, and yet know only of the glory of the culture, the one true church, and the language of the king. He has honored us with this land grant of so many acres of beauty and wealth, and we honor him tonight. Spain is truly here. Salud!
Salud!
I am not afraid of work.
Oh, sí, sí, por supuesto.
I know habla.
So, Rancho Santiago is different than the mission, no?
There are many young people.
Many young men, no?
Supongo.
Que son guapos,
perhaps.
Picture stuff everywhere. They have, you should see them in the carrera de caballos.
What horse race?
Es el mejor.
Oh, the men put a lariat in the circle.
Oh. Keep going.
Like this. Men, gracias. With the horses, they ride as fast as they can. Like this. Oh. Then they have to stop inside the circle. Like this.
They have so much power with the animals.
Cálmate!
The carrera del gallo is not so nice.
A rooster race?
Not quite, chica. The men bury a squawking rooster in the ground up to his neck. Then they ride by on their horses and try to pull the rooster out of the ground with one hand while they go by.
Now you're really scaring La Chica Nueva.
We did not do this at the mission.
Hey, shh! Los padres están aquí!
I
know. ¿Pasa nada?
No.
I swear I heard them.
You're clear.
I love it.
So is there any G-Swing?
Los padres!
Oh,
están aquí!
Keep going. I do not know.
Hola, señoritas. No need to stop talking. We have mas chisme. Come, walk with us.
Upon us this evening as well. The heavens have not opened up. Let me tell you, we are so far away from the city. By the time news gets to us, it is often old and filled with gossip. But this is much more than simple gossip. It would seem that we no longer belong to a Spain. The people in Mexico City did not like so much being ruled by Napoleon and his brother. The fighting was so far away, there was a revolution while we were sleeping in our beds. We are now Mexicanos. Spain now no longer has royal claim over us. I do know that we still belong to the one true church, and we must live according to the gospel. Now, I know some of my brethren, some of our leaders, have not always lived according to his will, especially towards those with no power. I will spend the rest of my days repenting the abuse carried out by the priesthood and begging God's forgiveness. Until then, all I can do is pray and feed the people as Christ did. Gloria al Padre, al Hijo, y al Espíritu Santo, como era en el principio, ahora y siempre, por los siglos de los siglos. Amen. Please, enjoy a tortilla. They are a little cold. They are our test tortillas. Please, enjoy. If you will.
Debido a las circunstancias, nos encontramos de pronto amenazados por hordas de migrantes yanquis, ya que han empezado a fluir hacia nuestra tierra, y ante cuyos avances no podemos permanecer inmóviles. Ya las caravanas de esos pérfidos individuos han escalado hasta las cimas casi inestables de Sierra Nevada, cruzado el continente entero y penetrado en el fértil valle de Sacramento. These are the circumstances. We are suddenly threatened by hordes of Yankee immigrants who have started to flow into our land and whose progress we can't stop. Caravans of these perfidious people have climbed to the almost inaccessible tops of the Sierra Nevada, crossed the whole continent, and entered the fertile Sacramento Valley. ¿Qué es lo que haremos entonces? Debemos permanecer sentados mientras estos atrevidos extranjeros toman posesión de nuestras fértiles llanuras y gradualmente nos van superando en número y arrinconando.
debemos dejar pasar esas incursiones desapercibidas hasta que nos hagamos extraños en nuestras propias tierras. No podemos hacerle frente nosotros solos. Y la marea de migrantes nos hará la tarea cada día más compleja. What will we do then? Should we stay seated while these daring foreigners take over our fertile plains, gradually outnumbering us and cornering us?
Never stop.
Should we let these raids go unnoticed until we become strangers in our own land?
No.
We cannot let them stand against us. The tide of immigrants will make this task increasingly complex. Señores, we are in the most unusual moment in time. We have only just removed the shackles of Spain's colonialism, and we now stand at risk of losing our culture and language. So much change for one lifetime. The only answer is to stand united as Californios. But enough politics for tonight. We are here to celebrate. Gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the most beautiful and talented singer in all of California, La Más Bella, Laura Moya. Muchísimas gracias, eh? Es un placer tenerte aquí. Everyone, I present to you here the most gorgeous of all. I'm telling you, she's the greatest ever. Muchas gracias, eh? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Laura Moya.
Yay! Laura! Vamos, Laura!
Now I hope you all dance while I sing.
A bailar! No party. Remember, no,
¡Gracias!
I think I remember you. You still got that money you owe me? Remember that money a long time ago we betted on the horses? No. Oh, yeah. Oh, now you don't know, huh? But you were bugging about it last month. You know, here's what we'll do. I find your card. You don't pay me at all. Actually, no. You will pay me. I don't find your card. You don't pay me at all. We'll try it, okay? Take your card. Now, hold on to that, too, for right now, okay? Just want that for a second. Okay, darling? Oh, my God. Try, let's put it on top, okay? On top, now watch, right? This is your card right here, watch. Next month when I see you again, you'll have to give me that money back, all right?
Oh, see, thank you. Laura,
so excited.
Aquí, como estábamos.
As this place was.
Como este lugar era.
But you know what happened.
Pero ustedes saben lo que pasó.
Pío Pico's fears were not unfounded.
Los temores de Pío Pico no eran infundados.
Those daring foreigners did take over our fertile plains.
Esos atrevidos extranjeros sí tomaron nuestras tierras.
There was a war.
Hubo una guerra.
And a treaty.
Y un trato.
Before, it seemed we no longer belonged to Spain. Suddenly, we now no longer belong to Mexico.
Antes parecía que ya no pertenecíamos a España. De repente, ya no pertenecíamos a México.
The Yorba family continued to live in El Rancho Santiago for many years. They sold it, but his descendants continued to live and learn in this very place.
La familia Jordan vivió en el Rancho Santiago por muchos años. Lo vendieron, pero sus ancestros siguen viviendo y aprendiendo en este mismo lugar.
Pío Pico continued to live an extravagant lifestyle.
Pío Pico continuó viviendo una vida extravagante.
Like this land, he lived through Spanish, Mexican, and American rule.
Como esta tierra, vivió entre dominio español, mexicano, y americano.
He accepted the American sovereignty only very reluctantly.
Aceptó la soberanía americana a gritos ardientes.
He was very rich until bad gambling debts and the flood washed away his fortunes.
Era muy rico hasta que débito y una corriente le quitó su fortuna.
You now know how our fortunes ended. All we can ask now is that you pray for our souls.
Towards the ghost lights. Come on, a little closer. It's just this light, not a ghost. We just call it that. All theaters have a light like this, so that when we turn the lights off at the end of the night, the stagehands can find their way out and back in again, since there are no windows, no daylight appears. We call it a ghost light, because aside from the very practical need for it ourselves, we like to think that it keeps the ghost company late at night. And every theater calls it that, because every respectable theater has its own ghosts.
Theater people are, as a breed, incredibly superstitious. For example, you can never say the name of Shakespeare's great Scottish play in a theater if you want to keep your life. But because of the terrible accents and mayhem uttering the name will cause, and also because the cast and crew will probably throw you out on the streets if they hear you. You can also never, under any circumstances, whistle in a theater. It's terrible luck. That one actually has a very unsuperstitious origin. Retired sailors used to be hired as the backstage crew, since they were strong enough to lift the set pieces in and out using the rigging system over there, due to their years hoisting heavy sails. And on a ship, a whistle was used as a cue to raise or lower a sail. So if one of you whistled in a theater where a sailor was working, you could very well get a set piece dropped on your head in return.
Like all superstitions, there's a little truth and a little flair for the dramatic. We are in the business of drama, after all. So, do theater ghosts exist? Are the thousands of sightings proof of unhappy deaths? Or the remains of some intense emotions felt on stage? Why can't these spirits move on? And of course, the answer to that is what? And give up show business?
All right, folks, we need you to line up
against the curtain, please.
Set pieces, lights, all the magic we don't want you to see gets hung way up there in the fly space, way above the stage. Lots of theaters have what we call a catwalk, so that stagehands can get up there and walk around to fix things or help set pieces make their way down to the stage. One such theater in Philadelphia also had a catwalk up there, the City of Brotherly Love. And on that catwalk worked a stagehand who'd watch the vaudeville show beneath him every night. He had secret dreams of becoming a performer himself, but he was too shy. As he watched from above, he soon fell head over heels in love with one of the ladies of the chorus. Every night, he would watch her turn and kick and leap, and he knew in his soul that she was his one true love. But being shy as he was, he didn't tell of his feelings. He continued to watch and to long from the catwalk. One night, after months of admiring her from afar, he finally worked up the courage to tell her of his feelings. Chorus girl rejected him, flat out, and left for the night along with everyone else. The unhappy stagehand stayed behind, completely overcome by her rejection. He took some spare rope and went back up to the catwalk, tying the rope around his neck as he walked. He let himself fall from above to the stage, as had so many set pieces before. In the following decades, cast and crew, late at night in the theater, would see this unhappy stagehand wandering the catwalk. One young actor, who scoffed at these visions, tried to prove how silly these claims were by spending a night by himself in the theater. The next morning, they found his body, with rope burns around his neck. Thank you.
This way, please.
All right, half of you, I need you guys to come this way. So everyone on this way, we're going to go here.
We're going to be going to the house now. Down to the stairs. Been to New York City, it's very likely you've seen a show at the Belasco Theater. That theater is named after the man who wrote, directed, and produced over 50 plays in that space. Belasco loved the theater so much that he even lived above it in a penthouse apartment. Many famous people were in his shows starting in 1907, from Antoinette Perry, you know the lady the Tonys are named after, Cecil B. DeMille, Mary Pickford, to Lionel Barrymore. Belasco was a bit eccentric, as show people often are, and was called the Bishop of Broadway because he had the habit of wearing priest robes in his daily life. Belasco also had the habit of smoking cigars and of calling chorus girls up to his apartment, sending down the small private elevator to the stage level to collect his girl of choice, and then back up to the private suite. After he died, it soon became clear that Belasco was not ready to leave his namesake theater. Actors stepping onto the stage would notice a lone figure in the balcony, watching them. A man, dressed in priest robes, who no one knew, would congratulate members on a fine performance. Actresses complained about the man who would pinch them on behind, dressed in priest robes. The smell of cigar smoke permeated productions in which no one smoked, closed doors on set open for no reason. Most confusingly, the small private elevator can be heard ascending and descending, even though the shaft is sealed and the motor has long since been disconnected. She realized that she had forgotten an important prop, a fan that she needed for the scene. She told a stagehand that she'd forgotten it and ran back to her dressing room again. The actress was never seen again. We know she got the fan sent back for because both the fan and the taffeta dress were missing as well. No one in the company nor the town saw her leave the theater, which would have been impossible to go unseen or unnoticed. Miss Vicky, as she has since become known, was never seen again in life.
But her ghost is seen frequently in the Victorian theater. Not only is she seen, but she is sensed in other ways. The smell of her perfume is sometimes overpowering, even in rooms where no one has been recently. The sound of her taffeta swishing quickly by has often terrified people who thought they were alone. People complaining of heat have felt the cool relief of her fan without knowing the source of the breeze. While the mystery of her disappearance was based on how she left the theater, it seems clear now that Miss Vicky never left, and hasn't yet. You'll not be following my companion up those stairs and out to the lobby.
Unfortunately, not all mysterious disappearances and deaths occur to those working in the theater. Sometimes audience members are lost as well. The Kimo Theater, a historic landmark in New Mexico, was the location of such an unfortunate occurrence. A group of young boys were spending a summer day trying to avoid the heat in a matinee. One of them, a young boy named Bobby, decided that he needed some refreshments, more specifically some sweets, and ran out into a lobby such as this. As Bobby ran along the walls, the boiler in the basement exploded, taking out that section of the lobby, as well as young Bobby. His young friends wept, and his parents were grief-stricken. Bobby's spirit stayed in the theater, and to this day has never left. Not only has it stayed in the theater, it has also stayed 6 years old. Of all the ghosts we know, this is the most precocious. Bobby never lost his incredible sweet tooth. And cast and crew of the following decades would leave donuts on the pipes in homage to him. The donuts would always be gone the next morning, except for the flavors he didn't like, which would have a small bite taken out of them. One year, a new assistant stage manager who wasn't familiar with Bobby saw the picked over stale donuts and, fearing ants, threw them out without another thought. That night's technical rehearsal of Christmas Carol instantaneously became a disaster zone. Set pieces were falling over for no reason, lights were going out when they should be on, and actors were getting injured. Producers panicked. Fortunately, the house manager saw the missing donuts and set out to satisfy Bobby's sweet tooth with some more donuts. The production went back to normal and had a very successful run.
This way, please. We'll be heading into the balcony. A century ago, the New Amsterdam Theater was home to the famous Ziegfeld Follies. Olive Thomas won the most beautiful girl in New York City in 1914, and was quickly hired by Florenz Ziegfeld to star in his risque show, where the richest and most powerful men quickly fell in love with her and showered her with expensive gifts and jewels. Ziegfeld himself was not immune to Olive's charms, and they had a passionate affair. Wanted Ziegfeld to leave his wife, which he would not do for her, nor any of the other Follies girls he would have dalliances with. Many other men pursued Olive, including Jack Pickford. You remember from our story about Belasco that his sister, Mary Pickford, was a famous star of the stage and silent screen. She was so famous that she was able to get Jack and the rest of the Pickford family into show business as well. And Jack was a handsome movie star. Olive made her choice. She left Ziegfeld in the Follies, married Jack, and moved to Hollywood to star in silent films herself. Her career was a great success, but her marriage was a difficult one. They were often fighting and making up, and filming schedules for both of them meant long periods away from one another. So, they decided to take a second honeymoon to Paris. Days and nights of romance and champagne made Olive incredibly happy. Until one evening, in their hotel room, she found the blue medicine bottle that proved her husband's infidelity. Mercury, to treat syphilis. Not only had he been unfaithful, he had made her sick as well. Olive thought back to the choices she had made to leave the city she loved in New York to follow this man who had betrayed her. She despaired and drank the bottle of mercury down. In death, she returned to the New Amsterdam as she had been, young, beautiful, and carefree. She appears, always stunning in Follies costumes, always holding the blue bottle in hand. She is known to be coquettish with men and jealous of pretty women. Today, there's a picture of her hanging above the stage door, and anyone leaving the theater says goodnight to her and blows her a kiss. It's wise to stay on her good side. Right this way, folks. We'll be going back into the lobby. Thank you.
Fort Camp Theater in Minneapolis, opened in 1921. It was a great spot on the Boswell circuit, as well as for early musical comedies. In those days, childcare was equipped with the price of admission, so parents could drop off their infants and young children to be cared for while they enjoyed the show. Long been out of fashion, but at the Orpheum Theater, it seems to have returned. Although no nannies nor children were ever lost during the Vaudeville days, it seems they have chosen to return to the theater in the afterlife. Employees constantly hear the sound of babies crying, even when there are no infants on the premises, followed by the gentle hushing of a woman. One sound technician reportedly quit his job after a uniformed nanny scolded him for amplifying the music so loud that he was waking all the children. sometimes, when it is very quiet, you can hear the women singing lullabies as they rock the children to sleep.
Okay.